earlier when I said, yeah, we have music like this all the time, I wasn't just talking about the quartet. I was talking about having Fritz here, too. That was Fritz Schindler, and Fritz was raised in this church. He, his parents, Charlie and Tommy Sue Schindler, were members here for many, many years. And then several years ago, they just went up and went out to, what was it, Radford, Virginia? Is that where you guys live now? Radford, Virginia, out there doing missionary work. And we're hoping that someday God leads you guys back here because, man, we miss you. Fritz, that was beautiful, buddy. Thank you so much. Fritz, yesterday did a workshop on the hammered dulcimer at Shaker Village. Is that right? Led a workshop there. And then so he texted me a few days ago and said, hey, I'm going to be in town. You know, you need me to do anything? I'm like, yeah. So, buddy, it is so good to have you here. Praise God. All right. We have been studying through the book of Romans. Now, in last week's sermon, we discussed how when someone becomes a follower of Jesus, the Holy Spirit of God comes and lives inside that person. As I said in last week's sermon, a Christian is someone who lives in God and in whom God lives. The Apostle Paul teaches us that since the Spirit of God lives in us, then we should live according to God's Spirit and not merely according to our flesh. Now, let's begin this sermon by reading the last couple of verses from last week, and then we'll go on. So if you would, please take your Bibles and turn with me to the book of Romans, chapter 8. That's page 800 in those Bibles in the pews. Romans, chapter 8. In Romans 8, let's begin in verse 12. And there, Paul writes, therefore, brothers and sisters, we have an obligation, but it is not to the flesh to live according to it. For if you live according to the flesh, you will die. But if by the Spirit you put to death the misdeeds of the body, you will live. For those who are led by the Spirit of God are the children of God. Paul contrasts those who are led by the Spirit of God with those who are led by the flesh. Now, in earlier sermons, we discussed what Paul means when he talks about living according to the flesh. Living according to the flesh means living in line with our own sinful desires and dependent on our own strength. That's what it means to live according to the flesh, to live according to our own sinful desires and dependent on our own strength. So with that in mind, let me ask you this, and I'm asking this of myself as well as of you. When you make decisions, big or small, are you led by the Spirit of God, or are you led by the flesh? Or to put it another way, are the decisions you make based on your own desires and determined by the limits of your own strength, or are your decisions based on submission to the will of God and dependent on His strength? Are you and I choosing to follow the leading of the Spirit of God or the leading of our flesh? This is a question that we dare not ignore. Because, as the first note in the note sheets provided in the bulletin says, we live in a culture that persistently indoctrinates us to follow our flesh. We live in a culture that persistently indoctrinates us to follow our flesh. We are told over and over again, follow your dreams. Follow your heart. Follow yourself. Be true to yourself. From children's cartoons, popular music, educational leaders, Hollywood movies, celebrities, self-help gurus. We hear the same mantra over and over again. You should follow you. Some even believe that the most virtuous, the most noble thing that a person can do is to be true to themselves, to follow themselves. But here's the thing. That message is completely opposite to what we hear from Jesus. In Luke 9:23, it says, "Then he, Jesus, said to them all, 'Whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves and take up their cross daily and follow me.'" The world says, how do you find life? How do you fulfill yourself as a person? You follow you. You be true to you. Jesus says, if you want life, the life that God has created us, the abundant life he's created us to live, then that doesn't come about by us following ourselves. Jesus says, then we must deny ourselves and instead follow him. Or as the note sheet puts it, we have not been placed on this planet so we can learn to be true to ourselves. We are here so we may learn to be true to God. We've not been placed on this planet so we can learn to be true to ourselves. We're here to learn to be true to God. And what that's getting at is we are here to prepare to be citizens of the heavenly kingdom. Our character to be shaped in such a way so we're ready to live in heaven. Because you see, heaven, sometimes people think, well, heaven's all about, that's where our dreams come true. No. Heaven is where God's dreams for us come true. So what we've got to do here on earth is we've got to learn to be true to God. Because if we don't learn to be true to God, heaven's not going to be that much fun. We're not here to follow ourselves. We're not here to live for ourselves. We're not here to be true to ourselves. We're here to learn to be true to God. We're here to learn to be citizens of the heavenly kingdom. So, in how you live, are you led more by the flesh or by the Spirit of God? The answer to that question is of the utmost importance because, as we read, Romans 8:14, Paul said, "For those who are led by the Spirit of God are the children of God." Those who are led by the Spirit of God, they're the ones who are the children of God. Are you a child of God? Am I really a child of God? According to what the Apostle Paul says here, only those who are led by the Spirit of God are truly children of God. Are you a child of God? Now maybe you're listening to this, and maybe we have some folks thinking something along the lines of, hold on, Kevin, wait a second. I thought that everyone was a child of God. I thought all human beings were children of God. Though it may be politically correct to say that everyone is a child of God, it is not biblically correct to say that. That's not what we're taught in Scripture. In Genesis 1, we read that all people have been created in the image of God. Throughout the Bible, John 3:16, for example, we read God loves everyone, no matter who we are. All of us have been created in the image of God. All of us are loved by God. However, while everyone is created in God's image and loved by God, not everyone is a child of God. For example, in the first chapter of the Gospel of Luke, when we read about how the Word of God
Jesus came to live among us, we read this. John 1, we read, He is talking about Jesus. He came into the very world He created, but the world didn't recognize Him. He came to His own people, and even they rejected Him. But to all who believed Him and accepted Him, He gave the right to what? Become children of God. They are reborn, not with a physical birth resulting from human passion or plan, but a birth that comes from God. Not everyone is a child of God. However, through Jesus, we all can become children of God. That invitation is offered by God to everyone. People are not automatically children of God, but everyone has been invited by God to become His child. And when we believe in Jesus, accepting Him as Savior and Lord, His Spirit, the Holy Spirit, comes to live inside of us, and He leads us and He guides us. We're no longer led by the flesh, we're led by the Spirit. Let's go back to Romans 8. Look there in verse 14, and then we'll continue on. Again, Paul writes, "For those who are led by the Spirit of God are the children of God. The Spirit you received does not make you slaves so that you live in fear again. Rather, the Spirit you received brought about your adoption to sonship. And by Him we cry, Abba, Father." In His relationship with us, God doesn't just want servants. He wants family. God doesn't want us to be slaves who obey Him only because we fear Him. God wants us to be His children who obey Him because we love Him. God doesn't merely command us to obey Him. God invites us to become members of His own family. He doesn't just want worshipers, He wants family. In Ephesians 1, verse 5, there's this beautiful verse from the Apostle Paul. He writes, "God decided in advance to adopt us into His own family by bringing us to Himself through Jesus Christ. This is what He wanted to do, and it gave Him great pleasure." Jesus came, died on the cross, paying for our sins, rose from the dead. Through all this, God has invited us to become members of His family, and God does not do this begrudgingly. If you've ever had any feelings of, man, I want to ask God to forgive me my sin, and I want to follow Him and everything, but man, after how I've messed up and blown it and not been what I should be, I mean, God, please save me. Please forgive me. Please let me be Your child. I'm sorry to bother You. I'm sorry. Listen, God is eager to forgive. He is eager to save. He is eager to redeem. It is not a bother to Him. It's what He wanted to do, to invite us, to adopt us as His children. It's what He wanted to do, and it gave Him great pleasure. You are not a bother to God. He looks at every single one of us. He says, come. Come, be my child. Adopting us gives Him great pleasure. God wants us to worship Him. But He doesn't just want us as worshipers. God wants us to serve Him. But He doesn't just want us as servants. God wants us as His family. And He has gladly chosen to adopt us.
his true son. Adoption has changed my life, but it's also changed my relationship with my father.
Now we can be called the children.
an old friend of mine, Larry Nichols. He and his wife, Angela, are in the process of adopting a little girl from China. They're only about 6 to 8 weeks away from flying over there and meeting their daughter. And they are thrilled. They are so excited. Some of you have been through adoption. Some of you have been adopted. Some of you have adopted children. And you know the joy that's part of that. Listen. God decided in advance to adopt us into His own family by bringing us to Himself through Jesus Christ. This is what He wanted to do. And it gave Him great pleasure. The wonderful experience of salvation not only means a new connection with God, but also a new connection with the people of God. For example, in Colossians 1:2, the Apostle Paul begins that letter by saying, "We are writing to God's holy people in the city of Colossae, who are faithful brothers and sisters in Christ. May God, our Father, give you grace and peace." As the note sheet says, through Jesus, we are not only connected with God, we're connected with each other. We are family. Salvation, we're not just connected to God. We're connected with each other. We're family. British pastor John Stott, writing about this in his book, Basic Christianity, he wrote this: "The Christian life is not just a private affair of your own. If we are born again into God's family, not only has He become our Father, but every other believer in the world, whatever his nation or denomination, has become our brother or sister in Christ." Amen? If you're a follower of Jesus, then God is your loving Heavenly Father, and everyone else who follows Jesus too is your brother or your sister. You see, salvation is not just about getting people to believe certain things and pray a certain prayer to receive Jesus. Salvation is about welcoming someone, not just to God, but also to God's family. Welcoming someone into a community of faith. It's about welcoming them into the family of God. Salvation means you have a new eternal relationship with God and with God's children. This connection with each other is an aspect of salvation that we often miss. We don't emphasize this nearly often enough. When I say, "Yes, Lord, I want to know You as my Father," that is, when I choose to accept His offer of salvation, I am also, it's part of a package deal, I am also choosing to accept His children as my brothers and sisters. I'm choosing to be part of the family of God. We have a tendency to think that accepting Jesus as Savior and Lord, getting saved, is something that's just between me and God, and it doesn't have anything to do with anyone else. That's not true. That's not true. God doesn't just welcome me into a relationship with Himself. God also knits me together with His followers. As the note sheet puts it, when we get saved, God expects us to accept each other as family. God expects us to accept each other as family. We are to be the family of God to each other. We must, listen to this word, we must choose to be family. We must choose to be family. We must recognize that the bond we share through the Spirit of God is real and eternal. Did you know that if you are my brother or sister in Christ, then the bond that you and I share together is much more real and lasting than the bond that I have with some of the members of my own biological family. I'm related to them by blood. You and I are related by the blood of Jesus. And mere blood does not bring eternal life. But the blood of Jesus does. That's the connection that we have. One of the best things about church is that we're a family, right? And one of the worst things about church is that we're a family, right? How many of you know that most families, at some point, it's work. Being in close relationship with anybody for a long period of time, it's work. In every family, you've got your crazy uncles, strange aunts, but they're family. And we love them anyway, right? One of the best things about church is that it's a family. One of the worst things about church is that it's a family. What I mean is that all too often, we carry into our church family the same kind of dysfunction we participate in and experience in our families at home. We can bring the same relational dynamics into this family. For example, we can get bent out of shape over the smallest of things. Or we can get bent out of shape if the church makes a decision that doesn't go the way I think it should have gone. We can get our feelings hurt. We can start to hold each other at a distance. We can give each other guilt trips, trying to emotionally manipulate others to get them to behave the way they ought to behave, the way we want them to behave. Families don't do that, do they? How about this one? We'll assume that we know each other's real motives, although we may be totally wrong. Or we just won't spend any quality time with each other. We'll just smile to each other in passing, but we don't really truly connect with each other. We don't really share life with each other. That happens in church families. That happens in some of our families at home too, doesn't it? Well, we're going in so many different directions so fast, we just smile at each other in the hall, see ya. Have a short conversation on the way to this, on the way to that, but we start getting more and more distant from each other. You know, I don't think that's the way it's supposed to be. God doesn't want that for any family, including his own. I want to read a beautiful passage to you. This is from Colossians chapter 3, the Apostle Paul. He's writing to the Christians there in Colossae, and he says this, "Therefore, as God's chosen people, holy and dearly loved, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Bear with each other and forgive one another. If any of you has a grievance against someone, forgive as the Lord forgave you. And over all these virtues, put on love, which binds them all together in perfect unity." I don't know what it's like with your children or what it was like when you were growing up, if you have siblings, what it was like with you and your siblings. But my sister, I have a younger sister, and I don't know how many times I heard my mom and dad saying to me and my sister, "You guys need to be nice to each other. Quit picking on each other. Quit aggravating each other. Love each other." Well, now, Felicity and I, we have a six-year-old little girl and a little boy that's about 3 weeks from being four. And what do you think we're saying? Be nice to each other. Don't take that from them. That's not yours. Be kind to each other. You're supposed to love each other. Kids, right? That's just part of kids growing up as siblings, right? I wonder how many times God looks at his family, at his kids, and he's saying to us, be kind to each other. Forgive one another. Be patient with one another. Let it go. Love each other. Be committed to each other. Spend time with each other. Play nice with your sister. Be kind and patient with your brother. Berea Baptist Church, thank God, is made up of many different people from many different backgrounds. It's one of the things I love about Berea Baptist so much. We didn't all go to the same schools. We don't all have the same level of educational attainment. We don't all have the same economic status. We don't all have the same hobbies or interests. We don't all cheer for the same sports teams. We don't all share the same color of skin or have the same ethnic backgrounds. But we are all part of the same family. Sharpie, can I borrow you for a minute? Sharpie, come here. Sharpie's from Africa. He's a student at Berea College. Stand up here with me. It's okay. I know you're taller than me, but you can stand up here. Okay. This is Sharpie. We do not have the same mother. Guess what? We have the same father. We have the same father. This is my brother. At least, I hope you claim me. You claim me as your brother, don't you? Okay, I didn't want to put you on the spot. Yeah, thanks, buddy. You have a seat. We have the same father. We are family. And he and I are going to be brothers for eternity. For eternity. We are all part of the same family. We all have the same father. And here's the thing. He's not just our father. He's not just our father. He, God, has welcomed us closer to him than father. Closer to him than that. Verse 15, Romans 8, 15, if you're still there. Paul wrote this. He says, the Spirit you received does not make you slaves so that you live in fear again. Rather, the Spirit you received brought about your adoption to sonship, and by him we cry, Abba, Father, Abba. As the note sheet says, Almighty God, our Father, invites us to call him Abba. Are you familiar with that word? I know many of you are, but perhaps some of you are not. Abba. In the Gospel of Mark, Jesus speaks to God his Father and calls him Abba. Abba. It's an Aramaic word. Aramaic is the language that Jesus and his disciples and their whole area there in ancient Palestine, that was their primary language, was Aramaic. They also spoke Hebrew, and most of them also spoke Greek. But the primary language, their heart language for most of the people living there was Aramaic. And then Aramaic word, Abba, didn't just mean father. It meant father, but it goes beyond that. What Abba means is something closer to Papa or Daddy. And Jesus modeled this for us and taught his disciples to speak to God and call him Abba, Papa, Daddy. Dr. Craig Keener, he's a professor of New Testament over at Asbury Seminary. Dr. Keener is an expert in ancient first century cultures. This is what he writes about that word. He says, Abba is a term of great intimacy and affectionate respect. It was typically the first word a child would utter. But adults could use it for their fathers as well. And students sometimes used it of their teachers. Perhaps because it implied such intimacy, Jewish people never used it of God, though they did call him a heavenly Father. For them, that word Abba was just too impersonal. It might be too pretentious. Is that assuming too much, God? We know we can call you Father, but Abba, maybe that's just assuming too much. But that's not what Jesus taught. Jesus taught us that God welcomes us to call Him Father. Jesus called Him Abba. Jesus taught us to look to God and say, Abba. So let me ask you this. Do you have a heavenly Father or a heavenly Daddy? Do you have an Abba? Or do you just have a God? There's a difference. Are you a child of God? We're going to finish up with verse 16 there in Romans 8. Verse 16, Paul wrote, "The Spirit Himself," that's the Holy Spirit of God, "the Spirit Himself testifies with our spirit that we are God's children." Does the Spirit of God live in you? Through His Spirit, can you sense the voice of God speaking deep within you saying, "You are my child"? God invites each of us to be adopted into His family through Jesus Christ. Through Jesus, God invites each of us to know Him, not only as Creator, not only as Almighty God, and not even just as our Heavenly Father, but also as our Abba, our spiritual father, our spiritual papa, our spiritual daddy. That brings us to the last note in the note sheet. True Christianity is not a religion. It is a relationship with the one who created all that is. True Christianity is not a religion. It is a relationship with the one who created all that is. The only one who is completely good, holy, righteous, and just, and yet welcomes us into His house, not as mere slaves, but as dearly loved children. Have you heard the voice of our Abba calling out to you? If so, how have you been responding to His invitation? In my prayer times, in my private conversations with God, I often operate on the level of Heavenly Father. In my better times, I pray on the level of Abba. And when I pray that, knowing what it means, when I say Abba, Papa, it gets uncomfortable. Not because of anything on God's end, but on my end. And here's why. Because when I pray on that level, it reminds me that I am not nearly as self-sufficient and grown up and mature as I think I am. I am a child. Most adults don't like feeling like children, do we? My children don't like feeling like children. They want to do it all on their own. But when I let my guard down and when I remember that to God I will always just be a child, and when I pray to Him on that level, Abba, there is an intimacy that occurs that isn't in the Heavenly Father level of praying. Listen, no matter how old you are, and I know we've got some folks here, you've been around the sun a lot of times. I'm not going to call you out. No matter how old any of us get, compared to God, we will always just be children. Children. He has adopted us as His children. It was His great pleasure to do so. And when we look to Him, no matter how old we are, and we say, Abba, it gives Him great pleasure. Do you have a God? Or do you have an Abba? Would you stand? I'm going to ask musicians to take their places. And as they come to their places, would you please pray with me? Let's pray.